Hi, my name is Georgios Piliouras, and today I'll be talking about learning in zero-sum games and some difference between continuous and discrete time dynamics. So the basic question that we'll be exploring in this talk is whether learning converts to equilibria in zero-sum games. And when we think of zero-sum games, you can think of simple two-player games like rock, paper, scissors, where you know, the amount of money that I win is exactly equal to the amount of money that my opponent is losing. Although, for the context of this talk, we'll mostly focus on the case of two-player games, a lot of this mathematical technology will actually extend and will be able to apply in much larger constant-sum network economies. So you can think of it here as a network with many, many agents, but where no amount of resources is allowed to enter or escape the network, which in some sense is a closed-loop system. Okay, from the perspective of machine learning, zero-sum games have become very, very interesting in recent years due to a number of like different machine learning architectures. One of them is the setting of generative adversarial networks. So in this case, we have two different neural networks, the generator and the discriminator. And the generator effectively is trying to create artificial faces that are like very realistic, whereas the discriminator is shown samples of real faces and artificially generated faces and tries to distinguish them and say which one is which. Okay, so these two networks are trying to outcompete each other, and through this competition we can actually create very strong generators, so that is like programs that already, although they have not seen any human face, they can actually create images of very, very realistic faces as the one shown on this slide. Another application of interest that's connected to zero-sum games is that of AlphaGo or AlphaStar architectures. So these are like architectures developed by DeepMind to create agents which can play, say, the play of a game of Go or a computer game of StarCraft at a superhuman level. And again, at its core, this architecture have this idea of a zero-sum game, or where, let's say, two different artificial agents are playing against each other and trying to outcompete each other. And by such and by this internal competition, you know, they manage to create agents with superhuman capabilities. All right. Despite this, you know, recent interest, of course, for zero-sum games, zero-sum games and the theory has pre-existed machine learning by many, many decades. And indeed, from the perspective of economics, this is a theory that this is an area that's effectively solved. Now, as this statement by Nobel-winning economist Robert Outcome shows, like economists really consider that zero-sum games is this one of the very few areas of game theory. And in fact, in the social sciences, where a very sharp and unique prediction is made. And this prediction is the notion of a nice equilibrium. So let's try to understand this from the perspective of an example. So here's such a prototypical zero-sum game. It's the rock, paper, scissors game played by, you know, two players, the row player and the column player. And this is their respective utilities for each possible outcome in the game. And a nice equilibrium is just a tuple of randomized strategies, like one for each agent, such that no agent can unilaterally deviate from the current strategy and strictly increase their payoff. Okay. So in this very simple example, the nice equilibrium is just a pair of uniform distributions. And it's easy to see that in this case, both agents get zero in expectation and they cannot do anything better given their opponent's behavior. Okay, so this value, this zero value, is known as the value of the zero-sum game. And okay, this is a very simple example, but this is actually indicative of a much deeper theorem. And this theorem is actually due to von Neumann, and is known as the minimax theorem. In some sense, it's like one of the most fundamental theorems of game theory as a whole. And it says that in every two-player zero-sum game with finitely many strategies, there exists a value and a mixed strategy for each player such that given the second player strategy, the best payoff possible for the first agent is V, and vice versa, given the first player strategy, the best possible payoff for the second agent is minus V. So intuitively here, this, what this actually means is like you don't get any advantage by playing second. Regardless of whether you play first or whether you play second and you have full knowledge of your opponent's strategy, you can always guarantee your value by just playing your equilibrium or your max min or min max strategy. Okay, so this is effectively the unique prediction that Robert Aumann somehow was referring to. But as we see, when we start somehow to consider the dynamics, the behavior, the picture can actually become significantly more complicated. So in the case of, in continuous time, so as we'll see, learning in zero-sum games has a lot of similarities with classic conservative systems. So think of an ideal pendulum or many-body problem, etc. And as we know, in many of the systems, we have a notion of energy that's being preserved over time. And the existence of these invariant functions will imply oscillatory behavior for effectively all initial conditions. On the other hand, so when we go from continuous time to discrete time, the behavior actually will highly depend on the discretization scheme that we actually use. Okay? And as we see, different discretization schemes will imply different properties from the perspective of both game theory and optimization. All right, so this is somehow like the large plan. Okay, let's start to understand this behavior of continuous and discrete time dynamics. And now we'll go into more specifics about what are the exact dynamics that we'll be studying. And we'll focus on dynamics that are known as no-regret dynamics. And this regret is a property of online algorithm that says the following. So I want to compare the total payoff that an algorithm has received over some T time periods with some benchmark. And this benchmark is the cumulative payoff of the best fixed action with hindsight. So for example, like I'm playing rock, paper, scissors on this red agent, the raw agent, and I'm playing rock, paper, scissors against my opponent for, let's say, 1,000 time periods. And now I'm looking at my expected payoff over this 1,000 time periods, given, you know, the randomness of my behavior and my opponent's behavior. And now I want to compare this with what it was the best fixed action with hindsight. So what if, you know, I had full knowledge of my opponent's behavior, and then I figured out that like rock was the best out of the three actions, rock was the best for me, the best fixed action over the first 1,000 plays. And then I want this ratio effectively to the time average of this ratio to go to zero. Or equivalently, I want this difference to grow sublinearly with time. And indeed, due to classical work by, you know, Blackwell and Hanan in the 50s, it's known that there exist such simple algorithms whose time average you get does go to zero. And these algorithms are actually important for zero-sum games because, it is known that the time average behavior of any pair of no-regret dynamics converges to the set of Nash equilibria. Okay, so, but what we'll be interested in is not what happens in the time average sense, but we'll be interested in what happens to the day-to-day behavior. Okay, so does the day-to-day behavior of these dynamics actually converge to the uniform distribution, for example, in the case of rock, paper, scissors, or does it cycle around, and in what sense does it cycle around? Okay, so this is really our question. And now we'll go into some further details about the class of algorithms that we'll be studying. And specifically, we'll be exploring this notion, this family of follow the regularized leader dynamics. And this is a family of dynamics that performs a kind of exploitation trade-off. So here's how these dynamics work. You have a vector, which is effectively like a memory register for each of your strategies. So you have one entry for rock, one entry for paper, one entry for scissors. And each of these entries captures the cumulative the cumulative payoff of that action so far, let's say in the first 1,000 time periods. Okay, and now when it comes for time to choose your action, your randomized action on day, let's say 1,001, you solve this optimization problem. And if this regularized term was not here, what would this maximization problem do? It would actually choose with probability one the action that behaved best for me in the future. Okay, so you would say, for give me, play with probability one, the action that was the best in the first 1,000 time periods. And this is a little bit too myopically aggressive. It doesn't perform any exploration of strategies that are like just slightly suboptimal. So in order to force the algorithm to randomize, we subtract this strongly convex function. As a result, this whole function is strictly concave, and hence this maximization problem is always well defined and has a unique solution. Okay, so this is what the algorithm does at every single time step. You know, it looks at how the actions have behaved so far, and then it outputs a probability distribution that solves this maximization problem. And now we can immediately go from discrete time to continuous time by just substituting the summation with an integral, okay? And everything else somehow follows immediately with the same logic. And for specific type of regularizers, we can get a closed form solutions for this dynamical system. And one of the most well-studied ones is the follow the regularized leader dynamic in the case where the regularizer is the negative Shannon entropy. In that case, one can show with a little bit of algebra that that the follow the regularized leader dynamics reduces to this type of ODE that's known as the replicator dynamics, which is a very well-studied dynamics in evolution and in the study of mathematical biology. And here's how to think about this differential equation. So X of alpha is the probability of playing action alpha. And now what the replicator says is that like this this rate of I will only increase my probability of playing action alpha if my current utility, given the state of the system for playing action alpha, is greater than my current expected utility of my current mixture, okay, over all of my strats. So I only increase the probabilities of actions that behave better than my current mixture. And this continuous time system is a continuous time analog of the well-known algorithms known as the multiplicative weight updates, also known as weight majority, winnow, or boosting. And here I should point out that different regularizers can give us different dynamics. For example, if we use the square of the Euclidean norm, then the corresponding dynamic is the online gradient descent, and so on and so forth. So we can get many, many interesting dynamics, but let's think of replicator as our prototypical dynamic within this class of follow the regularized leader. Okay, now here's a full model, okay? So we have two algorithms, let's assume both of them for simplicity are for sake of exposition, are the replicator, and they're both being fed into this zero-sum game. So now they create a closed loop system, a dynamical system, since the output of one replicator becomes like an input for the other, okay? And here's now what we'd like to understand is how does the system behave over time? And to do so, let's start by running some simple experiments. So here's the rock, paper, scissors game, and here's two different initial conditions, one for the row player, the red one, and one for the column player. And then let's assume that we just start running the system and we see this kind of recurrent behavior in this dynamics, this kind of like toroid. And then we can also like try different type of initial condition. And then we see again, another kind of like toroid behavior like emerging. And so as you see, the systems are in some sense appear recurrent. And there's another set of properties that, that becomes obvious. And if you look at these two little white pearls, this corresponds to the equilibrium strategies for the respective players. This is the uniform distribution. And as you see, the dynamics stay far away from it. Okay? And this is the kind of properties that I would like to be able to prove. You know, the dynamics actually do not even come close to equilibrium, but instead they sort of like cycle into themselves. Okay? So how are we going to do this? Well, it's a little bit not so obvious how to do it, because the simplest thing one could hope to see is that if you were to plot, for example, the probabilities of head, you know, of playing heads, sorry, of playing a rock for the first player or for playing rock for the second player, then they will have like a simple waveform function, like a sinusoid or something. And then we'll try to, you know, use these properties to like somehow like guess maybe a solution for the ODE and so on and so forth. Unfortunately, that's not the case. As you see, the trajectories can be quite complex. And at the same time, the red curve shows the time average of the blue curve. So it's the time average behavior of playing rock. And as we see, as we expected, this value seems to convert to the 1/3 output, which is exactly the equilibrium value for rock, paper, scissors, okay? And indeed, analytically, it was shown that in early work that these dynamics can actually be rather unpredictable, and hence the complete theoretical analysis of them was not clear of how one should proceed with that. Nevertheless, we'll provide some concrete statements here. So, and here's our key theorem. So if a zero-sum game has a fully mixed Nash equilibrium, then the FTRL dynamics do not converge to the equilibrium. And in fact, if you start a wave, if you don't start from equilibrium, you always remain bound away from it. And what's most interesting is the second statement that says, given any open set of initial conditions, almost all trajectories that start from this set return to it infinitely often. So indeed, we have this kind of recurrent behavior as our simulations have suggested. Now the remaining case, so the case of the fully mixed NAS is the case effectively of rock, paper, scissors, where we have an equilibrium where both players play all of their strategies with positive probability. Okay, and such an equilibrium are known as fully mixed or inferior NAS. Now there's the complement of these games, which is the case where the game does not have an inferior or a fully mixed equilibrium. Then it is known that in all zero-sum games, the set of Nash equilibria is always a convex polytope. So in some sense, there's a unique maximum equilibrium support. Just take a look at the support of the body center of this polytope. Okay, and then what happens is that the simplex will actually converges to the subsimplex of this support. Okay. So the dynamics forget all strategies that are not played by some Nash equilibrium and converge in this more constrained subspace. And once again, in this subspace, the dynamics become recurrent. Okay, and analogous results extend the case of affine transformations of zero-sum games. Okay, and also as we suggested in network generalizations. Okay, so it does not, we don't necessarily need to have just two players, but we can have like arbitrary many players in the network. And as long as every edge in the network effectively corresponds to some constant sum gain, then the results also will carry over. And finally, I should say that like this, the special case of a replicator was analyzed previously by another joint paper of myself and Jeff Sanner. Okay, so this is currently our understanding of the behavior of continuous time follow the regularized linear dynamics in zero-sum games. And now we'd like to take a deeper look of how one can actually try to prove these systems and how these theorems, and actually how can we sort of like, you know, leverage these connections with more standard techniques, I would say, in dynamical systems. And the key idea here is that we need a very powerful theorem from dynamical systems theory, and this theorem would be the Poincaré-Recurrence theorem. Okay, so Poincaré-Recurrence theorem states exactly that certain systems will, after a sufficiently long but finite time, return to a state that's very close to their initial state. And the two conditions that are needed is that, first of all, that dynamics preserves the volume of any set of initial conditions. So as any set is being pushed forward along the dynamics, the shape of the set can change, but its volume has to stay the same. And second is that the system orbits remain bounded, okay, that you cannot escape to infinity. And interesting enough, you can actually have like a nice visual depiction of the Poincaré recurrence theorem, because, you know, effectively an image is a point in a high dimension space. So it's like we need 300 by 300 pixels, and then we need maybe three numbers from 0 to 1, continuous numbers between 0 and 1, to encode the RGB values. So effectively, you know, pictures are, you know, points in a 300 times 300 times 3 space. And now we can define a dynamic that actually preserves volume in this space and feed it one such picture and see what happens after taking many, many iterations of this map over the system. And as we see initially, it seems that like all the information of the initial picture is like hopelessly scrambled and lost. But then if we iterate enough times, as the system suggests, we return to a point that is arbitrarily close to where we started from. And then you can clearly visually see this because the picture looks indistinguishable from the original picture. Okay. So now the question is that like, why and in what sense this kind of property is satisfied by learning dynamics in zero-sum games? And here's what are going to be our three steps of the proof. Step number one, show that our system preserves volume. Step number two, prove that the system trajectories are bounded, and then we're ready to apply the Poincaré recurrence theorem. Okay. So one thing that is going to be a critical observation is that actually we're not going to somehow argue about recurrence in the original space of product of simplices, but we're actually going to perform a smooth and reversible change of variables, and then employ these two steps. All right, and it will be easy to see, it will be easy to understand these arguments by a simple example. Here's the simplest possible setting of a zero-sum game. It's like we have two players, the row player and the column player, and they're playing this matching pennies game, right? And here, effectively, our system has like 2 degrees of freedom, the probability for the first player of playing heads and the probability for the second player of playing heads, since these two numbers must sum up to 1, okay? But instead of like somehow plotting the dynamics on the space of these 2 degrees of freedom, I'm going to do this diffeomorphisms, and I'm going to use these different variables zeta1 and zeta2. And a useful observation here is that in this new space, the equilibrium has moved from the 50-50 point to the center of the system of equations. So because if both of these numbers is equal to 0.5, then ln of 1 is equal to 0. So the equilibrium of the system is exactly here. And now we're going to take a set of initial conditions, and I'm going to try to move it forward and see what happens. And an observation that actually would be critical is that what is actually new variables encode, they encode something that's like very useful from a game theoretic perspective. It captures the difference between the cumulative payoff that the first player has received for playing heads minus the difference for the cumulative payoff for the first player of playing tails and similarly for the second player. Okay. And so this is the, somehow like a very useful space for us to sort of like make arguments about volume preservation. And indeed, somehow if we start moving the dynamics forward in this new space, we see that okay, our initial set of conditions is being deformed, it's being like stretched out in some sense like spaghettified. But the two interesting observations here. Well, first of all, maybe pictorially we see that the system is not really changing so much in volume, although this is something we have to also, of course, like analytically verify. But the other thing that's also like very important is that we clearly see that the trajectories do not escape to infinity. So somehow, if we're able like to formally prove these two properties in this space, then we can immediately apply the Poincaré recurrence theorem and prove our theorem for learning games. Okay, so we'll do that by applying Liouville's theorem. So Liouville exactly defined the necessary property for a system to be volume preserving, and this is based on this notion of divergence, which is just the trace of a Jacobian of our system. So it's this sum of partial derivatives. How does the speed along the x-axis is being impacted by infinitesimal move along the x-axis plus the corresponding term for the y-axis and z-axis. And a system preserves volume if and only if its divergence is equal to zero everywhere, okay? So that's exactly what we want to show. We want to show that our systems are divergent free. And as we say, I mean, from the definition of the FTL dynamics, it's immediately obvious that instead of like keeping track of it suffices to keep track of the accumulated payoffs in order to find out the correct distributions for all agents, because that's exactly what every agent does. Every agent takes their accumulative payoffs and then solves an optimization problem that just depends on them and on the regularizer, for example, on the negative entropy function, and outputs a unique probability distribution. So this exactly is the relevant space. And it will actually, it's easy to see that like, as long as we subtract from our original vector, any sort of like a constant vector, for example, like the cumulative, a vector whose all elements capture the cumulative payoffs for playing like a specific benchmark strategy, for example, the strategy rock, here, let's say the strategy zero, then the solution to this optimization problem does not change. So in effect, this is going to be the variables that are really going to be the critical ones. And in these variables, it's actually relatively straightforward to show that that our system is divergent free. And this is because this quantity, this is just the difference between the accumulative payoff for action for agent I for playing some action A alpha minus the accumulative payoff for that agent for playing action zero. So, but the time derivative of this quantity is exactly the current utility for agent I for playing action alpha minus his current utility for playing action zero. But this is a quantity that does not depend on anything that action that agent I is doing. It depends on all of the other agents. So all of these terms are actually going to be identically equal to zero. And hence, all of these dynamics are divergent free. Okay. So, and as we see, so we have this divergence free property, and we actually proved it without using any property about the game as a whole. For example, the game is zero sum, that the game is a two agent game. This is like a much more general statement. But now we're going to have to prove that the trajectories are bounded. And here's where the special nature of the game comes into play, right? So in the case of replicator dynamics, the analysis here actually is going to be relatively more straightforward. There's this notion of distance, pseudo distance between distribution that's known as the Kullback-Leibler divergence. And this is its functional form given to probability distributions P and Q. And right now you should think of this notion as a notion of a pseudometric. So it's a function that's non-negative everywhere, and it's equal to zero if and only if these distributions are equal to each other. Okay. And the key property when you play, let's say, replicator dynamics in rock, paper, scissors, is that the sum of these two distances, of the distance of between each player and their respective mass equilibrium, is constant. So as we see, once one of the agents gets closer to his equilibrium, the other agent must get further away, so that the sum of these distances always remains equal to zero. Okay, and also like this actually implies that we have to stay bound away from the boundary, because near the boundary is where the, say, where the KL divergence actually becomes infinite. Okay, so so this would be like an argument. This is a kind of conservation law that we get for Piliouras dynamics. In the case of more general follow the regularized Euler dynamics, we need a generalization of the above notion. And this is where some connections with convex analysis come into play. So there's this notion of a convex conjugate of the regularizer that is defined by this function. And it's also known as the Zender-Fenchel transform. And given this function, we can actually define a new invariant of the dynamics that has this form. Okay, so this is the convex conjugate. Yi is just the vector of the accumulative payoff of all agents. And Xi at mass equilibrium is just the mass equilibrium strategy of agent I. And the key insight here is that, like, as in the case of the KL divergence, you can think of this function as a notion of distance between, as a notion of distance for equilibrium, and it really implies that somehow that on the space of y's we remain bounded. So we get a second property that we needed for the for Poincaré recurrence theorem to apply, and now we can just immediately apply Poincaré recurrence. So let's put everything together here by a final set of simulations. So in this space, what we have, this is the transformed space. So this is the space that we'll see the, again, the set of initial black set of initial conditions like move along with time. And the color scheme here is indicates the value of the invariant function. So we want to see the effectively each of these dark points staying on its initial color. So some place in the green to like yellow regime. And here we have this potential well defined by the KL divergence. And once again, we see all of the points moving parallel to the x-axis as somehow the KL divergence remains constant over time. And in the last figure, we just see a volume estimation. And as we see, the volume of the initial set here as it's moving forward with time is actually remains constant over time. Okay, so visually somehow, or I would say experimentally verifying each of the statements that we have shown before. Okay, so we have like all of this. So now effectively we're able to apply Poincaré recurrence and prove our recurrence property of our dynamics. But now we can explore these connections with dynamical systems even deeper, and actually and establish formal connections to Hamiltonian systems. Okay, so Hamiltonian systems are systems that we're all familiar with from very simple physical systems. So we're think of like a simple pendulum where you have, let's say, the position and the momentum of this ball or of this, like, you know, of this weight, and then we can just apply Hamilton's equations given the Hamiltonian of the system to get the ODEs of the motion. Okay, and the interesting thing about this FTL dynamics is that if we interpret proper notions of position and momentum and kinetic and potential energy, that once again reflect the key notions in our game system. So the notion of position is just the total utility, whereas the notion of momentum is just the total probability of playing each action so far in the past. And these notions of potential kinetic energy that once again are connected to this notion of like convex conjugate, then we can establish these dynamics are not just volume preserving, but they're formally Hamiltonian systems. And once again, this kind of like generalizes previously known connections about connections between replicator and Hamiltonians now once again to all FTL dynamics. Okay. But of course, Hamiltonian systems are extremely well studied. And now you can really start thinking about, okay, what this tells us about these systems. For example, like what this tells us about a different type of integration techniques. And in the perspective, in the context of machine learning and also like online optimization, the most standard discretization technique for replicator dynamics was known as the multiplicative weight updates, which effectively just a simple Euler discretization. Okay. And now, and of course, the natural question is like, what happens if we study these discretized dynamics in the setting of zero sum games? And if we have this connection to Hamiltonians in mind, then this following result should not be too surprising. So this following result effectively says is like this multiplicative weight updates effectively is no longer stable, but it's always divergent away from the equilibrium and towards the boundary. And there's an interesting somehow phase transition in the systems. So if the speed, if the step sizes, if they decrease very fast with time, so let's say we have a time non-homogeneous system, whereas the step size are square integral, let's say they're like strictly less than infinity, then we're on this picture where, okay, the KL divergence of the dynamics increases, but we never reach the boundary. The total KL divergence remains bounded. Whereas if, for example, the step size is fixed, or if it's even not fixed, if it's slowly decreasing, like up to speed of 1/√t, then as we see, the dynamics effectively converge to the boundary. Okay, so by doing this kind of transition, you get instability, and actually, we don't just get divergence, but we get Lyapunov curves. So informally, we do once again the example of taking a set of initial conditions, and now we push it forward in time according to the dynamics. But now the dynamics are no longer volume preserving; they're clearly volume expanding. So this picture of this like image of a cat, as it's being pushed forward along the dynamics, it just like blows up very fast. Okay, so we have this effectively butterfly kind of effect, where any initial perturbation of the system is amplified very fast. Of course, this is like it's a very bad phenomenon, and there's a very natural question of whether we can actually somehow counter this phenomenon. And there's a very simple fix that, at least in the case of gradient descent dynamics, we can actually create a volume-preserving system that is once again recurrent, by just playing the discretized dynamics, but having the agents update in an alternating fashion. So for example, like the row player updates on the even time intervals, and the column player updates on the odd ones. So just by somehow like alternating between having the agents update in alternating fashion, we have these very strong properties for this dynamics. So effectively we can have all the positive properties of the continuous time dynamics, but in discrete time. Specifically, instead of having sublinear regret, we can prove bounded regret for even for non-zero sum games, but in this kind of settings. And we can actually prove the existence of new invariant functions, and moreover, the dynamics are volume preserving, and they remain recurrent. Okay, so so at this point, I think we're ready to just recap everything. So here's the, so we started by studying the dynamics of continuous time systems in zero sum games, and we see that we have periodic like behavior, or even formally periodic if the system is planar, like in the matching planes system. But now, once we discretized the system, as it happens, of course, in any sort of like real implementation of the systems in our computers, then discretization becomes critical. Simultaneous Euler divergence chaotically, whereas alternating optimization seems to be much better and being at least formally recurrent, at least for some of these systems. Okay. Now, one, of course, you know, keeping the initial prediction of the economists that Nash equilibria have these like good axiomatic properties, one could ask, okay, can we actually discretize the systems in different ways so that the equilibrium is being stabilized and we actually converge to equilibrium? And indeed, there's been a lot of recent work and ongoing work on this area, I would say, in the machine learning community. But I think there's still a lot to be done, especially when it comes to games where the cost function that the agents are trying to optimize is not does not have a bilinear fold, but it's a more general non-convex, non-concave segment. And I think there's a lot of like very interesting directions where dynamicists could actually help make significant contributions. So both in the case of continuous time dynamics, but also in the case of discrete time dynamics. So in the case of continuous dynamics, of course, we'd like to understand more detailed properties about the orbits of the systems. For example, like, you know, can we prove the existence of other invariant functions? Like, do we have periodic orbits and under what conditions and so on and so forth? And more generally, it would be very interesting to take very deep, but well-studied properties from the space of Hamiltonian dynamical systems literature and transfer it to the study of learning in games. And of course, there's a lot of work to be done on the discrete time setting with studying properties of different type of integrators. So what are the different trade-offs that we get in terms of stability and regret? More generally, their performance in this kind of settings. Thank you very much.